any of you watch the television or not. And in Robertson County, you can actually call it the television. Like we're going to the Walmart, you know. But if you've ever watched the television, then you see a little glimpse of what culture defines as beauty. What culture defines as important for a woman's beauty. We have seen the morph of woman's beauty throughout the years. Even soap commercials get into this, that a woman has got to look a certain way for them to be considered important, valuable, and beautiful. Society changes over time. Society redefines beauty in different ways. When you see Leonardo's painting, when you see these great historical works of art, you see different forms of beauty than what we see now. Society continues to change. God's got a different picture, but society continues to define beauty as a certain thing. And I fear that it places our mothers and our daughters and our ladies under such a pressure that is not necessary. Because so many mothers believe that they have to lose just that extra amount of weight, or they have to have this extra kind of look in their hair, or this certain kind of clothes, and honestly, that's not where it's at. And of course y'all know, like, yeah, of course church is going to say that, but that's not where everybody else is at. I don't care where everybody else is at. God has an ideal of beauty that he has shared with us throughout Scripture. Queen Vashti got it. The king didn't. Like most men, or a lot of men today, that, yeah, society, sure, condition my mind and teach me what I ought to think on beauty, and I want to impose that on my girlfriend or my wife or the lady in my life. And so, men, for us, it is our job to encourage, to lift up, and to be that support of this is what beauty is. Not what the Dove commercials or the Maybelline commercials or all these other commercials say, or MTV or Snooki or what everybody else says. It's not about all this stuff. It's about this. It's about what we see here in Esther. Queen Vashti was a strong lady. She was a woman that denied a king's request. You don't deny a king's request in this day and age. And Esther's day and age, without losing your life and your whole family's life and your community's life and your whole town and state and country's life. Such an action that Queen Vashti took actually has caused other people, not just their life or their family life, but their whole entire country's life. And we see there are some players within the story of Esther, one player by the name of Haman, that would love to use aspects, as we get into this story, to just abolish an entire people. Haman was a man that was pro-genocide. We'll get to him in just a minute. Vashti was strong. She was such a strong woman. The king wanted Vashti to show her beauty improperly. And she had a "no, he didn't" moment. Now granted, he's king, and he's got all this royalty, he's got all these things going, but she's queen. Now he can order her life to be gone, but outside of him, who's the next powerful person? You got the queen, because she is his right hand, supposedly. And could you imagine, possibly, the power within this woman that has either been taught through her position, or has been taught through her family, or whatever. But what we do see here is that Vashti was powerful in her mindset that, no, he didn't. And I'm not going to do what he said. Because he was wishing for her to show her beauty in an improper way. Well, what's happening here? When in Esther chapter 1, verses 4 through 9, we've seen the king has spent 186 days partying. Okay? 186 days. How many days are there in our calendar year?
365.
Yeah, okay. Alright. So 186 times 2. Yeah. Okay. That's a lot of days. It's many, many months. Okay? This man was a party man. He was partying and partying. He had come to this point after partying 186 days. And if any of us have ever partied, if you have ever had any experience partying, because of course we don't do that now, we're in church, right? We're not supposed to have fun, and we're supposed to be boring and all that kind of stuff, you know, partying and everything and drinks for everybody else. Now, granted, but we do have a different kind of fun around here. So, but drinking and clubbing and getting into things that you ought not to be getting into, yes. Of course, we're not doing that now because we're church folks, right? So, back then, though, if you partied longer than, I don't know, let's say 24 hours, I don't know how much booze somebody can take. That's a whole lot of hangover right there. But we see Hollywood people, and we see them all the time, and it seems like we're obsessed by watching these young ladies that raise up in the spotlight, and then they go out partying, and we just want to see all these horrible things in their life, and they're out partying and going to jail and then partying and then marrying somebody for 2 days and then not marrying somebody for 5 days and then something else, and we're obsessed about this. But it seems like their life is a constant party. The king had a party going on. 186 days is indicated in verse 10. And it says that he had wine. The heart of the king was merry with wine. At this point, we don't know about all the other 185, 86 days, but we know up to this point, his heart had become merry with wine. Now, since Hebrew speakers and Hebrew writers consider the heart to be the center of thought, another way to look at this is, on the seventh day, the wine had gone to the king's head. And he wasn't really acting the way that he ought to be acting. He was not really thinking with his full head when he was saying, I want my wife, the queen, to entertain us with her beauty in a very improper kind of way. Vashti was summoned to the purpose of displaying her beauty, and she refused to come before the king. How is it improper? Because we live in a world where women are dying to flaunt their beauty, or what the world calls as beauty, right? We live in a world where women are conditioned and seem to be forced to say, you look this way for all of society, because that's what the world deems as beauty. One of the first things that we see about her strength was that her beauty wasn't for anybody else but for the king. And if she was a godly woman, we don't have that. It was for God too. It wasn't for everybody else to see. The beauty of my wife is not for anybody else but for me. But sometimes we have this struggle that I want to look good going out. I want to look good whenever I go out, but whenever I'm just at home, I don't want to, you know, work as hard. But we have this upside down thing. Who cares what they think? What does our family see? And yes, mothers, a very similar Father's Day message is on its way. This should not be a, hey, do this. This should be more of a, here's a relief. Don't worry about what they think. Worry about that man at home, what he thinks. Worry about those children and how the beauty they see about you. Because sometimes we spend so much energy, so much time caring about what they think. When we get home, we just, I'm so tired. I don't have time to invest. Let me sleep for just a moment. Let me chill out in front of the television. Let me just chill. And then we miss the entire point of what the beauty has conjured for, what the beauty has been created for. It's not created for other people to start lusting after us. It's not created in such a way for people to envy us. Babe Ramsey keeps making this joke about people that, you know, have these really nice cars and all these things on the car and all these wheels on the car. And it's like, how in the world is that anything for you? All it is just showing off for somebody at the red light. That's it. And why do you even care what somebody at the red light thinks about you? It makes no sense, but you spend all this money on this one thing. So somebody at the red light thinks you're really cool for a few seconds, and then you're gone, and then you never see them again. But you're really cool for a few seconds. why you're taking food out of the mouth of your family to have this really cool 2 second moment. And then we miss that really awesome, beautiful moment with the family. My two top girls that I want to make sure that they know what daddy's all about is my wife and my daughter. And let me tell you how important this is. I know it's not Father's Day, but let me tell you how important this is for me. If I don't show my wife what a real man is, treat her like a real man ought to treat her, somebody else will. And ain't nobody gonna treat my wife special. My little girl, she's gonna have a man in her life one day. She's gonna have somebody that tries to court her. She already does on the playground as the little boys tell her, "We love you, Emma." Honey, when you leave this playground, you take a fistful of that rubber and chip stuff and you throw it in their face. Dad, that teacher says we're not supposed to do it. Grab it in their mouth. So with my daughter, I want her to have an image of a man in her life that just some boy with a fancy little smile just can't come and just swoop her away. Can't just say, "I love you," and then she's just, oh, smitten, because she's never heard that before. Or hugs her once and she's like, "Oh, whatever you want, it's yours," because she's never been hugged before. The beauty that I've got is for my daughter. What we see is that Vashti didn't want to display her beauty for everybody because it wasn't theirs. It was the king's. Yet he wasn't thinking in his right mind. It's actually customary for Persian women even not to even appear in public, because their thought is that if he's even getting out in public, there's a possibility somebody else will enjoy their beauty besides their family or husband. Vashti gave a party for the women, we see in verse 9. It was customary that the sexes did not intermingle in public parties. And the king knew this. So why in the world did he want his wife to come? Well, a couple of thoughts in the improperness of his action was, in verse 11 you see that she was to appear in her royal crown. Some thoughts, some historians have even suggested that she was to appear only in her royal crown. Another thought on the improperness of his request was that when Persian wives attended banquets with their husbands, they departed when the heavy drinking began. The wives would leave, leaving only concubines and prostitutes to stay. This is not a real godly party, by the way. And so for her to be requested to come back was like requesting a prostitute to come in to entertain them. That's how bad his marriage had gotten, that he was treating her like a prostitute. But how many marriages can we think of today where the wife or the family are treated in such an awful, awful manner? Because America has conditioned our mind. Our television, our Hollywood has conditioned our mind to think of beauty in a certain way. And we impose this into our marriage, into our families, saying this is what it's all about. And if you don't fit this mold that society says, you're not beautiful. Vashti was strong. She put her foot down and said, "That is not beauty." She was strong. Your actions, your words, and your ideas will show your beauty in life, ladies, mothers. Your actions, your words, and your ideas show your beauty. Not the size of a waist. Not how the hair is made. It is your actions. It is your words, your ideas, your heart, your soul is what's considered beautiful. If you're here today as a mother or as a wife, and you're like, "Man, I really am struggling to have this household that serves God," bring beauty in. Don't subject yourself to the world's ideas, but subject yourself to the beauty that God color makeup at Walmart. You're more valuable than some kind of gene. You're more valuable than what the world has to offer because God has created you for a specific task. God has made you beautiful. Stand on His beauty and don't let anyone else share with you otherwise. There were two farmers, for example, that looked at different things differently. Their actions and words and ideas showed who they were. The first farmer was very happy and always looked on the bright side of life. The second farmer was a pessimist. One bright sunny day, the first farmer got out in bed and said, "What a beautiful day. The sun is shining and it's going to help my crops grow." The second farmer got up and saw the sun was shining and said, "Great, now the sun is going to dry out all the fields and ruin all my crops." Well, the next day it was raining. The first farmer woke up and just exclaimed, "Bless the Lord! The rain will water my crops and help them grow." The second farmer said, "The rain is going to flood my fields and I surely won't profit this year and I'm surely not going to go to church in the rain." A few days later, the first farmer went to visit the second farmer to tell him about a new hunting dog he had bought and invited him to go hunting with him the next morning. At first, the second farmer was reluctant, of course, being a pessimist and did not really want to do everything, but then he finally agreed just so he could see how the dog would react. They sat out the next morning. It wasn't long until they saw the first duck. The duck landed on the pond, and the dog set out after it. When the dog hit the water, he actually skipped along the top of the water, picked the duck up, and skipped back. The first farmer said, "Did you see that?" "Yeah," replied the second farmer, "I knew that dog couldn't swim." Your beauty, who you are, is found in your ideas, in your actions, and your words. They both live the same exact life. One was contagious. The other was not. Let's catch in Esther chapter 2 as we have run completely out of time this morning. Esther spent many months and much effort to show her beauty properly. What we see in chapter 2 verse 7 verse 7 Esther enters the story while watching YouTube on her cell phone. Whatever it was. In chapter 2, we see that the beauty of Esther was prepared for 12 long months. And it wasn't just, "Hey, we've got to pluck your eyebrows and we got to get you looking good and you got to have the best thing from Versace." It wasn't all that. It was that her character and who she was had to be checked on and, "Hey, are you this?" and developed as an individual. The beauty of Esther took a long time to develop. The beauty, the discipleship, the character, but she was being developed even all the way up to this point. As Mordecai says later on in chapter 4, that it's for such a time as this that you have been given this opportunity. You have been prepared and trained all the way up to this point. What we see in life, the true beauty that we find with Esther, and the true beauty that we find with God takes time to work on. Your character, your heart, your soul, it takes time and investment to really build, to be the woman and the wife and the mother that the world so desperately needs to see. It's so easy to mimic someone else. It's so easy to live in someone else's shadow. It's so easy to be somebody else because there it is. If I cut my hair a certain way, if I talk a certain way, if I do this a certain way, I can be them. God's created them. But He's created you too. The world already has one of them. The world needs one of you too. But yet, a part of the world's beauty is here's the image of beauty. Mimic this and you will succeed. God is over here saying, "I've created you the way you are. You're unique. You're special. Nobody else is like you. And if you allow this to come, and in your body. Esther was true to God, so God gave her purpose. Esther 4:13, the Mordecai told them to reply to Esther, "Do not imagine that you are in the king's palace can escape any more than all the Jews. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance will arise from the Jews from another place, because God will deliver us as people. And your father's house will perish. And who knows whether you have not attained royalty for such a time as this." God can use anybody to decipher your family. God can use anybody to decipher your husband. God can use anybody to be that spot in your life. He's created you to do that, for that purpose. God's plan is still going to work. But how many of us want to be used by God? Esther was used by God. Vashti refused. And she got replaced. This allowed Esther to move into a place, to act in a godly manner for God, knowing God. This is why we think maybe Vashti was not godly, but although she had all the right things going about refusing his request, it is your chance in life to share the beauty of who you are. This morning, I wanted us to take a few minutes, the doctrine of mother, as we could look at all kinds of different things. But today, what I believe is needed most of all is a woman to shine her beauty in the face of everyone else. Despite what the television tells you, despite what the world tells you, despite what is going on, will you have the strength of Vashti and the endurance of Esther? Or will you let your life succumb to the beauty of someone else and ultimately become their doppelganger and their shadow?